Education is what's important. Training, preparation for the expected. Education, preparation for the unexpected.
And good afternoon, Team Krulak community. And on behalf of Marine Corps University, the Marine Corps University Foundation, and the Brew Krulak Center for Innovation and Future Warfare, welcome back to the Brewcast, our series designed to connect the worlds of the warfighter and PME with the best in innovative and creative thought. I'm your host, Major Ian Brown, Operations Officer at the Krulak Center. Before we begin, please remember that all opinions expressed here are those of the individual and do not necessarily reflect the views of the Krulak Center, Marine Corps University, the United States Marine Corps, or any other agency of the U.S. government. So today, building on our recent Brewcast about drone swarms, Team Krulak is excited to welcome Colonel Bill Edwards, United States Army, retired, to open the aperture on the global security challenges presented by commercial drones. There are millions of commercial drones in private hands. They're a multi-billion dollar global industry, and their proliferation and use on fields of conflict by conventional armies and non-state actors alike are limited only by their imaginations. Colonel Edwards will describe the challenges, countermeasures, and potential opportunities in this new security environment. Bill Edwards is president of Federal and Public Safety at Building Intelligence Incorporated. He retired from military service in 2017 and led Thornton Tomasetti's security consulting group as a principal from 2017 to 2021. He has over 34 years of expertise in operational and technical security, counterterrorism, counterintelligence, surveillance, and counter-surveillance. He is also co-author of Inside Abu Ghraib, Memoirs of Two U.S. Military Intelligence Officers. So, sir, welcome to the show, and I'll turn it over to you for your presentation.
Thanks for the introduction, and I'm glad we've got an audience today to go through this. I'm gonna share a presentation that I give quite often on the evolution of commercial drones, and what I'm hoping we can do is just have a conversation. I've been on this platform since my last combat tour in Iraq in 2010, 2011. And since that time have just developed more appreciation of what this technology is actually bringing to society, and then also the nefarious ways it can affect society, but also from a military conflict perspective. We have probably the biggest experiment or laboratory and experiment that's taking place right now is in Ukraine. And so we'll touch on that in this presentation. I'll just set the stage here. I'm going to give you some data points on commercial drones. We'll go through a little bit of Ukraine. We'll do some positive and negative aspects of drone technology or commercial drone technology. And then I'll give some recommendations on how we actually approach the topic from a security perspective, and ways that we're trying to train not only the services, but also private sector security professionals on how to deal with this technology. So let me share my screen and we'll get going here. And of course, just type your questions in. I don't claim to be an expert by any means, but I do think I have a lot of experience working in this space and talking about it and educating. So The presentation is called Killer Drones. I've been doing this again for several years now. It's called Disruption Today, Destruction Tomorrow. I think we're seeing that as we go into Ukraine. This is me. Ian's already gave that introduction, so we'll get right into the topic. So Killer Drones, what we're seeing, and really what I'm trying to do is focus on the commercial side of this type of technology. We all know that military technology is available. We know what the capabilities are. We've actually probably used some of this in our past careers, if you were in DOD or around DOD. But really what's super interesting is this convergence of commercial drones with military drone platforms in a conflict zone. And that, to me, has been eye-opening, especially with Ukraine. But when you look at the commercial drone market, and I'll say this up front, the first commercial drone was sold in 2010 by a company called Parrot, which is a French company. So if you think about it, this technology is not that old. It's about 12 years old. And so where we've come from 2010 to now 2022, from a capability perspective, is absolutely amazing. And it's almost, I equate it to almost like what we've seen in the cybersecurity world, where cyber was such a hot topic for so many years and how it developed. Drones are doing the same thing. Quickly, momentum is building. quickly developing different capabilities and getting that to the private sector with a simple click of Amazon, going to your Amazon app and buying these things off the shelf. So right now, quickly, 1.5 million registered unmanned vehicle aerial vehicles in the U.S. That does not account for probably over two million more that are out there that haven't been registered, because registration is all voluntary. So we don't really know how many commercial drones are in our airspace. The global market's going to grow by 20% is the prediction. To a profitable or a monetary capability of $43 billion in the market invested in this type of technology, and it continues to evolve. So some more background here, just drone figures and estimates. A year ago, we could report 60 countries had commercial drones or some drone technology. Now we're saying there's 95 countries that have this capability inside their country. 35 million drones are out there globally. It's probably more than that. Again, these estimates are just estimates. And then, of course, a lot of this technology is being developed for commercial use, 75% of it. And I mentioned that it's only 12 years old. But you can see why I'm sort of walking the dog on this, is because as we get more capable and the capacity grows, we're going to see this technology in our conflict zones, which is really important. But more importantly, we're going to see it in society. Just some quick notes on, and there are probably experts on the call that know way more about this than I do, but this is simply sensors, functions, and capability. What's really important to me is when I look at this, this is something I can buy off Amazon. I can go in, or I could go in a drone store and buy this capability right now. But sensors are very advanced, functions are advanced, and then capability and payloads are continuing to advance, but are also growing. So drones are able to carry different types of payloads, multiple payloads. And then also from the nefarious perspective, which I'll get into, we talk about ordnance and other types of payloads that are available, which we're seeing in the Ukraine conflict. This is one of the latest drones, if you're not familiar with it, manufactured by DJI, brought into the market most recently this year, called the Mike 30 or the M30. The capability on this commercially available drone is absolutely amazing. You should do some research on it. You should see what it's able to do. But this is absolutely at a level of military capability on the commercial market. And we're starting, in fact, I saw a photographer in my town recently had just bought one of these platforms. They go for about $29,000, $30,000, but businesses are starting to buy them for different uses. But if you can imagine, because we're only limited by our imagination with this technology, if you can imagine what this is capable of doing, it could be, it could actually not be good if there was in nefarious hands at this point. So what's driving the security interest in commercial drones? Well, obviously Ukraine. And what I wanted to point out, and there's a video here that Ian will share with you later that's embedded here. But first person view is something we've seen in the Ukraine conflict that is, to me, very scary. It's the capability of this operator here with goggles on to actually fly a drone directly into a directed target. So in this instance, what's happening here in this video, and this is the guy that's flying it, there's a Russian soldier in this building here smoking a cigarette outside this door. And this operator flies his drone into that door with ordnance and detonates it. So it's very precise surgical targeting from the front lines, from an operator with first person view capability, able to do that surgical targeting. So this is, I think, in my opinion, it's a game changer in many respects. And we need to pay attention to how this is evolving.
Very cool.
But this video is pretty interesting. And frankly, it's probably, I think the distance is about 3 kilometers, maybe. It's not too far from this operator to that building where they target Russian soldiers, you know, sitting in that building doing whatever, and are able to take them out with that drone instance. more on drones here. And one thing I wanted to highlight, I put it in the presentation. Let me go back. Oops, sorry. Presentation is the Iranian drone, which we've heard a lot about. That's the one here. It's called the Shahid 136, loitering munition. It's causing havoc for Ukrainian forces at this point. So we really need to, at least from the lessons learned perspective, we need to understand what are the CUAS, what are the counter UAS capabilities that we're going to have at our fingertips in order to defeat technology like this. And you're probably also familiar with Israeli Harpo and other loitering AI munitions that are on the battlefield and being used in this conflict that are frankly fairly scary. They're very highly technical, simply designed, but technically accurate is what I like to say. And then you see here in this example where the Russians are flying the KUB BLA kamikaze drone in Ukraine, which, you know, the payload's fairly significant, flight time not that significant, and then speed obviously significant. So all of this is coming into play, and we're seeing it before our very eyes. So I often tell my current peers, former peers, and then folks that are still in service that the lessons learned, we need to be taking these seriously and figuring out what we're going to do in the future modern battle, the next conflict or the modern battlefield. More on Ukraine and drones here. This drone here is the TB2, which you've probably heard a lot about. It's the Turkish-made drone. It's done a lot of damage to Russian forces. It's a very capable platform. It's fairly inexpensive. And it's actually the one that's made all the news over the last 6-7 months for Ukrainian forces. But what we're starting to see is you're seeing these ad hoc security or what we call TOCs in the military, tactical operations centers, joint operations centers. They're standing these up with drone capabilities in houses, in deserted buildings, anywhere they can set up, and they're starting to execute these drone operations. One key statistic that's super important is over 6,000 different platforms are being used in the Ukraine conflict, which, if you think about it, that's pretty amazing. But it's also other countries and other business, other capabilities taking advantage of the conflict to get their system into the fight and tested. And so really what we're seeing is this live test environment with the convergence. Again, I'll go back, I'll beat that drum of commercial and military drones in the same conflict. This is an example of Russians converting DJI drones. I'll get into some of the platforms so that you're more familiar with it. I'm sure you already are, but this is DJI platforms here. And then this is an Orlan 10, which is a standard Russian drone. It's not sophisticated. We've seen it rigged in really, really weird ways with water bottles used as fuel tanks and Canon SLR cameras as the payload, which is really sort of silly in today's modern drone capabilities. But this is what the Russians are using. They also have the Orlan 30, which is the next advanced level of this same platform that actually has an ordnance delivery capability. And that has been injected into the fight as well. Again, just more, I think what was interesting, why I put this slide into the presentation, is this is one of the first times I've seen a senior level politician tell the citizens of the country to get their personal drones into the fight. So this quote down here, you may have seen it in the past, it was early on in the conflict, but this is a mobilization of the populace to bring their capability into the conflict. And then this is a Ukrainian army or Ukrainian Air Force drone called the Punisher that's been used quite a bit. Again, carries a pretty nice payload on it. More on Ukraine here. One of the reasons I put this in the presentation is that this is where we're seeing the idea of 3D printing. This is a 3D printed drone that was actually used in 2014 and 2015 in the early stages of this conflict. Most people don't realize this fight has been going on for several years. Started around 2014 with some trench warfare, some skirmishes back and forth across each of the lines. But the Ukrainians were actually employing 3D printed drones with ordnance on them as well. This is also very interesting if you haven't heard how Ukrainians are recycling. I'm sure everyone's familiar with this this e-cigarette called Juul. Well, Juul batteries are being recycled now to support drone warfare, which again, the creativity and the innovation that's taking place are things that need to be, we need to have a really good lessons learned book kept on this. This is a video, but it's really about Ukrainian drones setting up these individual tactical operations centers and flying these drones against Russian targets really without any issues. Now, the Russians are employing electronic warfare. We know that there are kinetic options as far as taking drones down as well. But what I'll get into in a little bit is what we're thinking about from, at least from the U.S. Army side, I've seen in the open press recently, is a layered approach to actually combating the threat of swarms, but also drones in the airspace in the conflict zone. So I'll touch on that a little bit as we move a little further through this.
We supply it every day around 100 drones, and users is civilian users, military users, and everybody started to use these drones to find some enemies in our country, and it's helpful. And I know many examples when it saved life of our Ukrainian people. So we have drones with thermal cameras from DJI and from another brands as well that used at night. So we see the soldiers at night, we see the tanks at night, and for sure it's scary to use a drone in Ukraine right now, because it's a huge risk for your life that you will be detected and destroyed by them. So you have to follow some rules to avoid to be detected.
They're constantly filming, and so they're gathering video, and then that video can be used in information warfare. That video can be sent viral across YouTube or Instagram or Twitter, you name it. The final thing that we haven't seen yet, but we can expect it'll happen, is the same way that small civilian drones were used in wars like Iraq, jury-rig arming them, basically taking the small drone and mounting some kind of weapon on it. In Iraq, for example, ISIS would mount hand grenades or mortar shells or homemade bombs onto the drone, and then they'd fly it over and it would drop it with this kind of homemade dropping mechanism. Some of them, they turned them into like kamikaze drones. So some of the, for example, DJI drones, they don't go over 40 miles per hour. You're not going to use a fighter jet to shoot it down. It'd be hard even for a helicopter. They're also, you know, they're like literally this big. So the responses to them range from, you know, old school using guns of some kind to what the US military turned to was a variety of jammers. And reportedly, the Russians have that kind of technology. We've seen images of their convoys, civilian vehicles that are not just about drone jamming, they're cell phone jamming. And we think this is going to be one of the things that they deploy into these cities as they also deploy the rest of their tanks and the like.
Again, another loitering munition that has a RPG-7 payload on it, right here in the nose of the drone. These are all things that are being created in Ukraine. And why is it important? Well, because our enemies are taking note. People are taking note on how this is actually being used. Mechanisms, we've seen this since our conflicts in Iraq and Afghanistan. I know I was on the end of the initial start of ISR from AQI's perspective in 2010. We were starting to see some of these platforms being converted, which was really interesting to me as a ground commander, but I had no way to defeat it at that point. But what we're seeing here in Syria, Afghanistan, Iraq was really where those TTPs, those techniques, tactics, and procedures were formed on how to arm these commercial platforms. And then, of course, on the right is an artist rendering. I just put it in here of a capability called Thor, which is really a directed energy capability, because we're starting to see a lot of interest in swarming. Most recently at the National Training Center, the Op-4 used a 40 swarm sortie against a Blue 4 unit at the National Training Center. So we're starting to see that we're implementing this type of technology in our training, which is really, really positive and great to see. By the way, that's in the open press. You can search, Google search that and see how the 11th ACR put out 40 drones in one sortie against, in not in a direct combat role, but in an ISR role, an intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance mission. Just some pictures here of how some of these things are rigged. So these cones are really pretty prevalent on these types of platforms. They're actually housing the ordnance. You can see this is a pretty big drone, but again, this is a smaller DJI drone. And then you can see these are outfitted with fins for stability. This is actually, I might be able to show this, Ian. I'll see. There's no sound to it, but this is actually a drone dropping a grenade on a assembly point in Syria. And you can see, not very accurate, but close enough to do some damage. And I think, you know, this is something we're starting to see with more precision in Ukraine now. This was back in 2014 or 15, I believe. This is a critical infrastructure video that I like to show. What happened here was Greenpeace, as you all know, an activist organization, they outfitted a commercial drone in a Superman outfit or costume, and they flew it without any ordnance into the side of a French nuclear facility. So why is that important? Well, critical infrastructure is a target in our country and in any other country, and drones could be that platform that bring the capability to do some destruction to it. In this case, the drone was not, it hit the side of the building and was destroyed. It didn't do any damage, but Greenpeace was sending the message that this is capability they have. And by the way, this was done several years ago. And since that time, the technology has completely evolved. So from a security perspective, from a former military perspective, it's something we need to really keep watch out on. And then, of course, prison deliveries. I'm sure you've heard of this. This is how we're getting different types of material into prisons. It's a big effort in the United States to protect our prisons from a drone detection capability.
Time to check out what's trending now in the story of an inmate who had every reason to keep an eye on the sky.
It had nothing to do with the weather. This is video from Euclid, where corrections officers say an inmate was looking for a package-carrying drone. Officials say the package contained tobacco and a cell phone. Prosecutors are now reviewing the case, though no additional charges have been filed against that inmate.
Wow, pretty innovative.
Yeah, and then just want to talk about some other things that are happening. Drones over our public events. You know, this is really important. You know, this article is 2017, but someone was experimenting with dropping leaflets over a NFL game. In my current position as a private sector security consultant, I do a lot of work with MLB and NFL and others, concerts, festivals, etc., that help them to plan and prepare for that drone event that may happen. Why is it important? Because everything we learn in a conflict zone or everything we experience in a conflict zone has the capability of making it back to the homelands. So, and that could be the United States, it could be Canada, it could be Central Europe, it doesn't matter. We're seeing these events all over the world. One interesting tidbit of fact is, for instance, New York City is a no-fly zone. New York City is a no-fly zone for commercial drones. But in fact, there are over, and last estimate, 1,000 drone sorties or flights into New York City every day. And so those type of things are happening where people are trying to get video of some sort of event, or they're trying to fly their drone from New Jersey into New York to see if they can make it happen. But if you think of it from a nefarious perspective, this is something we really need to start thinking about and worrying about. In 2020, We saw our first instance of an attack on U.S. critical infrastructure. This was actually reported a year after the event, so you can go in and search the event itself. But it was a drone with ordnance flown into critical infrastructure, I believe, in Pennsylvania. This is stuff we need to pay attention to. That's why I do this educational presentation on the evolution of the technology. And then, of course, you've all seen the attacks on Saudi Arabia over the last several years. What's interesting about this one is they were using cruise missiles and drones on the same attack as a feint to get the drones into the target. So the cruise missiles were used, obviously were capable of picking up cruise missiles. Drones flew under that radar, and the drones hit the oil refineries, causing major damage. So again, the creativity, the innovation in this technology is amazing. We saw the assassination attempt on the Iraqi prime minister. We also saw the assassination attempt on Maduro. We also saw the assassination attempt using a commercial drone on the Yemeni's minister of defense. All of these things, again, if you're thinking about this technology, we're only limited by our imagination. And this is BIOP. I'm sure pretty many of you might be associated with BIOP or know of it or been there, but this is the drone that actually hit BIOP most recently in the beginning of this year. I just want to point this out. This is a great, there's a web link here. It's called Worldwide Drone Events. You can click on it. We'll share it with you in the audience, but I put it in the presentation because you can click on it and you can go and explore all the drone events that are taking place across the globe. And it may be interesting to you to know that. So it's just a piece of information I share as part of the presentation, but it's kept by a company called Dedrone. And Dedrone is a drone detection and monitoring company, one of many in the market, but they do have a pretty sophisticated system. And I'll talk a little bit about laws and regulations within the United States so you understand where we're at. But I'm doing a lot of writing most recently on how we are very far behind the technology when it comes to regulations, laws, rules, however you want to frame it. But we're not setting ourselves up, at least in my opinion, for success as this technology enters. Not to mention that companies, large companies, are starting to really think about this technology for deliveries, right? So it opens up a whole nother example of why the conflict zones are so important for us to understand private sector. Implications, I've talked about some of this, but we've seen some really interesting events. I mentioned first person view with you early in the presentation in Ukraine. That's something I've seen that's new. And if you can think about it, that's pretty dangerous. But we're also seeing these loitering munitions, these AI-driven munitions. Some claim that they can autonomously actually select their own target. The Israeli Harpo's one. But that would be a scenario where you have the human out of the loop, which is important to understand when it comes to this technology. If you're interested in learning more, read a book called Army of None. It talks about AI and autonomous systems, but it's a very good lay down of human in the loop, human on the loop, and human out of the loop when it comes to robotics and drone technology. And by the way, I'm only talking about airborne assets here. We also have to start talking about land and sea drone capabilities. In fact, most recently, the Ukrainians launched a drone boat against the Russian fleet. Almost as a torpedo. So that stuff is starting to come into play in conflict as well. Here you can read this, but these are some of the negative aspects or implications of this technology. And then I also like to talk about positive. I won't dwell on it too much in this presentation, but the bottom line is the technology is going to be good for society as well. You know, there's going to be the ability to deliver medicines and services via drones. I mean, right now what we're struggling with is what's called UTM, unmanned traffic management, but we are also struggling with the over the horizon capability of urban air mobility. So think about your Uber driver is your drone platform. You may think that's crazy. It's not too far in the future. It's actually being tested. Now, if you're brave enough to get in one of those, send me a note. I would love to actually understand your experience. but I'm not there yet myself. But UAM, that's what it's called, Urban Air Mobility, and UTM, Unmanned Traffic Management, are some of the things that we're starting to really focus on when it comes to drone technology. Let's do a little discussion here quickly about drone detection and monitoring. So the Ukrainian problem right now is drone detection and monitoring, and then capability to actually do something about the capabilities they're facing is the problem. Drone detection in the US is pretty prevalent. There are many companies that sell it, mostly operate on an RF spectrum, so radio frequency. But what I've written about in the past, that if we're really going to bring this technology to bear, we need to have a layered system. We need to have RF sensors, radar sensors, optical, and even audio sensors to really pinpoint where drones are at. Because when you get into this airspace, you're going to pick up birds, you're going to pick up other things that are happening. So to really determine what is nefarious and what isn't, in a societal perspective, is different than a conflict zone, because you assume that everything coming towards you is a enemy capability. That's a little bit easier. But right now, as you see the Iranian loitering musicians inserted into the conflict zone, that's where the Ukrainians are having some problems now. And I think what we're going to see, just like in every major combat operation, it's an action-reaction scenario, similar to what we experienced in Iraq and Afghanistan with the IED or the IED capabilities. This is no different. Some of these you can consider airborne IEDs as well. But if you look here, on this slide, I talk about detection and monitoring that's getting better. Again, it's all about layering sensors. And this also is the same concept we have for kinetic action. So we have to layer our sensors, not only in a detection model, but in a kinetic scenario. So think actual kinetic engagement, high energy engagement. Then you might have EW environments where you're jamming. And then, of course, the third one I'm going to talk about, which I think is really important, is called take control, where you actually take control of the drone in flight and then land it at a location of your choosing. The future, this is really more geared toward what we're going to see in society, in my opinion. I say this all the time, but 200 to 400 feet AGL is going to be the drone superhighway. You're going to see deliveries, you're going to see all kinds of things, but you also have to add in there, how do we determine what is good and what is bad from those platforms that are flying? No different than in a conflict zone, although you do assume that if it's coming towards you, it is bad. So you have the ability to take it out of the air. I emphasize down here, which is something that most people are super interested in, which is the take control capability. And I'll get to the reason why we can't do that in the United States, but in the United States, take control happens to be something that's dealing with an airborne platform in flight. So we don't have the rules, the regulations, the laws to do that. That's why I say we're behind when this technology as it evolves, because as I've shown you, this technology is completely capable and it's simply a click away and a credit card purchase away. But bottom line is the future holds a lot for us in this technology. It's revolutionary, but more importantly, it's evolutionary, because drones have been around forever. Now we're starting to see the capability grow and grow and grow. And there's some pictures here of delivery options. Amazon's all into this, Google's into this, other big companies on how that's going to happen. And you see here, I mentioned about how laws have to change. We're going to need a champion in the legislative side of our government to help us with this. But what we can't do is we can't wait for that bad day to happen before we do something. So, again, the foot stomper there. I put this into the presentation. Again, these are links to laws by country and laws by U.S. state and country. You're more than welcome to explore these at your leisure. I mean, again, for your information, some of these are out. They may be a little outdated. I was having a hard time finding a website that was actually is being maintained all the time. So you'll have to play around with it a little bit, but these are a good place to start. And it actually color codes it, which is good for me because I'm a simple person. But it color codes on the type of drone activity, or I'm sorry, the type of law and regulation and how things are actually starting to take shape across the globe. Real quick on laws and regulations in the U.S., and this is actually a slide from a friend of mine who is with, I believe, Fordham Technologies. But I saw this at GSX a couple of weeks ago. But it's a really good summary of why response and mitigation is taking so long, because we have all these United States codes associated with flying platforms. So we're actually tying our own hands, and we're not addressing the technology as it evolves as quickly as we should. Now, the White House has a counter UAS action plan that's out. We've also seen the FAA's plans. If you're interested, go into my LinkedIn profile. You can read about what's actually happening. I just published an article through Forbes on this, of what's actually happening from a regulatory perspective. But here's the key. It's only focused on really the federal aspects and critical infrastructure for our company, our country. What we really need to think about also is, how does private sector affected by this technology, specifically since Ukraine is winning the information operations game, and then everything that you would want to know about drones is on YouTube, right? And you can go find it yourself. You can actually, there's how-to videos, which are amazingly open with what they're doing in Ukraine to employ this technology. Risk mitigation. Let me talk about this real quickly. I think I'm doing pretty good on time. Ian, am I doing pretty good on time?
Yeah, you're doing good on time,
sir.
Okay. What we're doing, and this is something that's applicable also to the military environment, is developing drone vulnerability risk assessments. We call them DVRAs. It's a model of how to actually determine point of launch locations, how a drone would navigate to your specific location, what waypoints would they use, what terrain features might they use to navigate. All of that is part of the drone vulnerability and risk assessment. The second is developing drone emergency response plans. This goes for DoD organizations, the services, private sector. It doesn't matter, but you've got to develop your plans, your policies, your procedures on how to deal with this technology. Tabletop exercises are always a great way to start with your planning staff, and then you develop that and blow that out into your unit organization and establish standard operating procedures, how you're going to react, countermeasures, all of those things that need to take shape in a normal, in an army model, it's the MDMP, right? But however you do your planning, that needs to take place from drone vulnerability risk assessment to drone policies and procedures to tabletop exercises. And then, of course, getting into what my final thoughts are here are actually countermeasures, or the CUAS, the counter unmanned aerial systems capabilities you may have. Recently, the Army published what they're doing about this. You can look that up, but they're looking at it from a layered approach. So they're talking about kinetic capability, which is the actual direct strike on a drone, which is very hard to do. Then if you have a swarm against your formation or against your property, even harder to do. So they're exploring electronic methods, and then of course take control. So again, when you think about drone detection, it's about RF sensors, radar, optical cameras, and audio sensors to detect, and then counter, same type of thought process, layer the systems from kinetic capability to electronic warfare to take control. So again, this whole idea of forming it into a process that is understood and then able to implement or employ is where we're headed. In society, we're not there because of rules, regulations, which I talked about. In the conflict zones, we have much more freedom and actually to exercise and test these capabilities, which is happening in Ukraine, which is why I upload in this presentation all the examples of what's going on and where we're headed in the future. Again, why is it important? Well, since 2017, I've been on the platform educating about the capability. Like I mentioned in the beginning, we kind of went through this with cyber. We've sort of got ourselves squared away, as we would say in the Army, as far as cyber is concerned. Now we're having to deal with these drone platforms. that are building momentum in capability every day, and we're just behind. So bottom line is this is more of a generalist presentation. I'm not a technical expert, but what I am trying to say is that this is something we need to wake up to. It's something that our lessons learned teams need to be documenting, and then we need to be getting this to the services as a new capability to think about. Recently, the U.S. SOCOM commander came out in the news and said, in all the time in his career, this is the first time he really has to think about looking up. So if you think about that comment, I think it's pretty prevalent. He's probably been in the military 40 plus years, and he's saying that this is the first time in his career that he really has to think about what's above him or over his head. That's pretty significant. So I'll end there. I think in here, Ian, I've embedded a pretty interesting little video clip of Gaza, where the Israelis are flying a drone over Gaza, and the Palestinians are using fireworks to deter the drone from its mission. So again, in this type of technology, the creativity and innovation we're seeing is amazing. We're only limited by that. That's why I foot stomp it all the time. And I always used to tell this to my soldiers, is especially in combat, that your enemy is not a potted plant. You have to remember that. Your enemy is not a potted plant. Your enemy's thinking. Your enemy is trying to outwit you. It's a cat and mouse game. It's an action reaction. And all these things are taking place. So we have to be really nimble and agile in our thought processes when it comes to drone technology. So I'll stop there. And if there's any questions I can answer, I'm happy to do that.
So first question from Jared Duff. This actually jumps off that one thing you mentioned in Ukraine with them using a maritime surface drone as a torpedo, basically. But he's asking, outside of that, have you seen any instances of surface drones, wheeled or tracked, commercial or otherwise, that have been leveraged, or and I guess subsurface as well, in the maritime space? So we had the one in Ukraine that you just mentioned. Have you seen anything else in this domain?
Yeah, we've actually seen it, and I think I'm accurate of saying this, but I think we've seen it in the Persian Gulf as well. So we've seen it in other AORs, areas of responsibilities. That's what the term is in the military, but AOR. But the point to make is that these systems, these different types of robotics, these different drone capabilities, it's not just limited to airborne platforms. It's land and sea now, and we're also seeing experimentation grow every day with underwater capability. And I think one of the instances that I'm trying to remember, but it was actually an attack on an oil platform and I can't remember exactly who launched it, but it was an autonomous maritime drone capability designed to strike an oil platform. Again, you can see only limited by imagination here, but we're starting. And if you look for the instance that happened in Ukraine recently, or I think in the Black Sea, look at that platform that they used. It's fairly sophisticated. And so I think in this case, though, it actually it went aground. It didn't hit its target, but they're going to refine that, and they're going to be able to use. They're building their lessons learned as well.
Great, thank you, sir. And you know, to the creativity point, yeah, as you were talking about the one hitting the oil platform, it reminded me, this is a little bit off base, but I think slightly related. I saw a video. It was like a how-to video on Twitter a little while ago, but it was someone who had made a remote-controlled Lego submarine that had full buoyancy control going up and down. And you know, you wanted, you know, the Ukrainian drone is sophisticated. Got it. You could build your own with Lego and potentially have some pretty interesting command and control capabilities on that if you're trying to change depth. You know, but the fact is, like, that stuff is out there, and it's very easily available, only limited to imagination. All right, so next question is from Albert Lee, and actually he's got a bunch in here. I'll do one at a time though, because they're pretty detailed. So his first one is, going back to Ukraine, there are some accounts that suggest that commercial drones are considered to be consumables due to their eventual loss to electronic warfare, incoming fire, counter UAS, mechanical failure, what have you. While commercial drones are reasonably plentiful on store shelves or their online shopping counterpoints, is this a supply chain you could count on in a high intensity conflict? And maybe to add to that, your perspective, would you look at their use in Ukraine right now? Is this high intensity conflict, or have we not seen how intense it could go in terms of, you know, having a lot of adapted commercial drones on the battlefield?
Yeah, to me, the term I would use is MCO, major combat operations. We're definitely in major combat operations that we're seeing in Ukraine. Not we, they are. As far as supply chain, I think what we're seeing, and I kind of alluded to it earlier, was this convergence, right, of platforms. So the private sector side, and now the what's actually given to the military from a procurement perspective, they're coming together, at least in this environment, right? We hadn't really seen this before. Will the supply chain be able to keep up? I think that it's absolutely capable of doing it. The only thing that would restrict us would be the supply chain mechanisms to get this type of equipment into conflict zones. But if you think about it, if it's a technology that we're learning right now is actually working for the Ukrainian military, it's working for the Russians as well, and they're able to replenish, you like you said, a consumable, because that's what these are. They're almost, in my opinion, they're fire and forget. Now they would like to be able to keep their ISR platforms for multiple use, but you know, that's why I mentioned early on also that 3D printing has come into play here, and they're also the recyclable battery capability through e-cigarettes. All these things are just amazingly creative and innovative. So this is going nowhere. It's only going to evolve more. And I think our supply capabilities, from at least from a DoD or service perspective, are going to have to take this into account as we start to deploy organizations in whatever future conflict that may be or wherever we're at. But this was not part of the kit when we went to Iraq and Afghanistan. But what we're seeing now, and really when you look at even go a little further back to the Azerbaijan-Armenian conflict, there was even another test environment for these platforms. And the reason there are 6,000 platforms operating in this environment is because there's the ability to test them and to see what they can do. This is a functional laboratory, if you want to put it in those terms. But every day I'm amazed at whatever is new. Recently, and sorry to take this longer, but I saw they outfitted a fairly sizable commercial drone with a mortar delivery capability, 60 millimeter mortar capability, that was functioning as a cyclic system. So it was dropping, it had a payload of 12 or 8 60 millimeter mortars, and then it cycled through on how it was dropping. Think about that. Think about how that's been created by this conflict.
I think
hopefully
I've seen
that video. Answers what you're saying.
No, it does. And I think I've seen video actually of that cyclic delivery system. You know, again, on Twitter, where all good things can be found. All right. So next question from Albert is is one of the original, quote, maybe the Panzer S1 isn't very good, end quote, stories is that it could not discern craft main drones manufactured by Syrian rebels from birds that were flying around the airbase. And he notes that while the U.S. probably has access to significantly better radars with IM SHORAD and other solutions coming down the line, but it's unlikely that such advanced radars with similar capabilities would become easily available to civilian security contractors or law enforcement of different levels. How do you see advanced drone detection capabilities working in the civilian space, you know, assuming the option is more than just placing full trust in a drone manufacturer's drone detection system?
Yeah, which we're never going to do. So great question. That, and you're referring to DJI's aeroscope capability, which only actually identifies DJI drones. Great question. This is all about layering sensors. And that's what I was trying to emphasize, not only with a counter UAS solution, but also with a detection and monitoring. Remember, break this problem into really two things: detection, monitoring. So you actually are looking for and seeking that drone and identifying if it is a drone or a bird, right? Determining what it is, or something else in the sky, a balloon maybe. And then you have your counter UAS capability. When it comes to the conflict zones, this is game on. We can do whatever we want. We can test systems, and we're doing a fairly good job of figuring out what's going to work. And again, that's in a layered package. So when I talk about layered, I'm talking about different technologies that give us different capability. In drone detection, you always, in my opinion, you want RF, radar, optical, and audio always in your package, because it's going to give you a different view of what that drone is. It's going to tell you if that, it's going to give you the ability to say, yes, that is a drone, or yes, that is a bird, right? And so that's why you have these different layered packages. Counter UAS, the same way. You want to have direct action capability. You want to have electronic warfare capability, and you also want to have a take control capability. If you can, but the problem for private sector, Albert, is that it's not affordable. They're not packaging it in a manner that people can actually buy it and afford to have it. Secondly, the rules and laws and regulations don't support anything other than detecting and monitoring and geolocation of the operator. So you can geolocate the operator without breaking any rules, but then you have to have some sort of law enforcement arm to QRF that operator, right? To quick reaction force to that specific location. There is no ability in private sector to take a drone out of its airspace or its flight. It's against the law. So that's a problem. That's a problem.
Great. Thanks, sir. All right. Another question from Albert, and this goes back to the potential for that drone superhighway you talked about, which I think was between 200 and 400 feet above ground level. For soft kill measures in a civilian environment, how could these be carried out without inadvertently disrupting lawful or legal drone traffic to include other law enforcement potentially as an unintended side effect?
Yeah, another, it's what I talked about, Albert, with UTM. So the problem that we have not solved, at least in we, and I'm saying society in general, is what is unmanned traffic management and what does it look like, right? So think in terms of the FAA manages all commercial airline and military air traffic in the airspace, right? We have a system that does that. We have air traffic controllers. How do we do that at the 200 to 400 foot level in an UAS environment when we don't have an unmanned traffic management system? We don't have one. And so this UTM problem is super important. And that's why we need legislation. That's why we need a champion. That's why we need serious thought on how that's going to take place. And to determine what is nefarious and what isn't is the next level of thought that needs to go in to that type of scenario. So UTM, remember that, unmanned traffic management, that's what's getting worked on, or at least people are starting to think about. And then think about what I mentioned about UAM, where companies want to provide or urban air mobility to citizens as a business. So how are you gonna manage that as well? And that becomes another UTM problem to solve. We're not even close. Well, the FAA did publish in 21, I believe, what's called a digital license plate ruling. So any drone as of September of 2023 that's purchased must have a digital license plate. But think about it. That doesn't account for the 35 million drones that are already flying in globally in the airspace. We're super far behind.
Great. Thank you, sir. All right. That's the last question I had in the chat here, although I am going to note that we had Lieutenant Colonel Travis Horde on here. And he's in charge of SOI East. And one thing he's going to do, and if you're permission, I'm going to put you directly in touch with him because he wants to discuss what the Marine Corps has been doing in terms of integrating Group 1 and 2 UAS with formations across the MAGTAF. And they've been doing, if you want more videos for a future presentation, they've been capturing a lot of that stuff and sharing it on social media. So if you're good, I'm going to put you in touch with him because he's been doing a lot of practical application for how this could work for the Marine Corps. All right. Like I said, no more questions. So coming up on an hour here, sir, do you have any final thoughts you'd like to share?
No, just thanks for giving me the platform today. Thanks for the time for people listening in. Again, it's all about education right now. It's all about thinking creatively about this technology. And you'll see me if you're on LinkedIn, you know, connect with me. I'm constantly talking about how this is evolving. It's not simply a federal problem. It's actually a societal evolution that we need to be taking quite a bit of notes on. And I look forward to your thoughts on it and appreciate your time. Thanks, Ian. I appreciate being on the platform here.
Great. Thank you, sir. And sorry, one more note to both yourself and the audience. all those links that we mentioned, I'm going to embed those as the full videos when I go through and edit this thing. So you're not going to miss any content. I'll put them all in there as well. All the links that were mentioned in terms of maps to worldwide drone events, drone laws, et cetera, I'm going to put those all in the show notes as well so that people can follow up and check those out. All right, sir, thank you very much for your time. To our audience, as always, thank you for joining us today. And keep your eyes open. Two things I'll mention here is, one, those who've been noting in the show notes recently, we've had a survey. We welcome your feedback on what we were doing for the Brewcast, as well as what we do for other items that we offer, both at Marine Corps University and in the digital realm. So please let us know how we're doing. Take 5 minutes. All comments are welcome, good, bad, or otherwise. We always want to improve our product. And then second, something to look forward to in the next couple of weeks here is we are coming up on the 100th episode of the Brewcast, and our plan is to have our director, Ms. Valerie Jackson, on to just take a look at what's been going on here at the Krulak Center, kind of as a retrospective, because we've been here for 4 years now. No year has looked the same as the previous one, and there's always something new and interesting coming, and we'll take a look back and take a look at the future as well. So once we get that date locked in, make sure you're following us on our email, distro, or social media channels to join in that one, because that 100 episodes, very exciting for any series. Never would have thought we'd make it at this point, but here we are. All right, sir, again, thank you very much, and appreciate your time.
Education is what's important. Training, preparation for the expected. Education, preparation for the unexpected.